British cinema. What British cinema? At the beginning of 1993, only two British films were being made here. But back in 1967, we had 76 British pictures in production, and Hollywood studios were tripping over each other to shoot their pictures in London. In the 60s, the British film industry went from relative obscurity to the center of the international film scene. In this series, we're going to look at how British films reflected the mood of that time as they sped from post-war realism to surreal satire, and we'll be talking to the stars, producers, and directors who put the 60s on the screen. I arrived here from America, a young television director on the make, in the mid-50s, when Britain was still a pretty staid sort of place. But by the time I got my break in feature film some 5 years later, there was a new spirit around, and we were about to be caught up in what is now rather dismissively referred to as swinging London. The films of the time reflected what life was like for young people in a rapidly changing moral climate. Something that was also reflected in the big popular success of the time, Alfie.
There was this manageress of a dry cleaners.
Alfie, Georgie Girl, all those sort of films were intrinsically British films, which were released all over the world and very successful. I wonder why we can't do it now.
The 60s produced a new generation of writers, directors, and even more importantly, stars, some of whom found the pressures of success hard to take.
Masses of attention, all these interviews, all this concentration on yourself, what you look like, what you think.
The hothouse atmosphere was one which interested director Joseph Losey, a refugee from the Hollywood witch hunts, who found his distinctive voice here in Britain in the 60s.
He had a pretty high regard for himself, and it was warranted, I think. He was always very interested in class, in British class. You know.
It was a funny period in fancy people's drawing rooms. You would see hairdressers and cooks and their plumber. Suddenly there was a total mingling of different classes.
Observers of the swinging scene also arrived from Europe, like Italy's Michelangelo Antonioni. In the dangerously confident spirit of the late 60s, Tony Richardson took a regiment of British actors and technicians into the Valley of Death to shoot The Charge of the Light Brigade. But this colorful decade began in black and white, in a spirit of brash vigor with a group of films that attracted admiration from some unexpected sources.
I think that this new English cinema was much more professional, much more sincere, not trying to impress by some peculiar style, you know. And in fact, it had more depth to it.
Cinema began here, in Halifax, in the north of England, when a young man named Joe Lambton drew into this station to start a new job in a new town. The year was 1958, and Joe Lambton was on the up. The Second World War had left cracks in the established order. People still knew their place, but not all of them were prepared to stay in it. Room at the Top introduced British cinemagoers to a new kind of hero, and to what was then a new and unfamiliar landscape, the north of England. The film was based on a best-selling novel which featured an unprecedented amount of sexual frankness. Joe Lambton took advantage of everything on offer. His impatience with establishment figures and his grasping for the better things in life made him terrifically appealing to post-austerity Britain. This northern lad on the make was played by Lawrence Harvey, who was actually from northern Lithuania. And looking at the film today, it's hard to imagine just how subversive his character was. But then, 50s Britain had been a curiously static and backward-looking place.
The climate was so different then. I mean, utterly different from what it is now. I mean, England was like a or the country. It's like a sleepy village after the war. And I suppose it was in a kind of state of trauma after all that. And nothing had happened, and there was this feeling of general torpor, and it's very difficult to engage anyone's attention.
You read about the grotesque and evil practices going on in the Midlands?
About the what?
And last week, a well-known debutante related how during an evil orgy at Market Harborough, she killed and drank the blood of a white cockle. Bet Portland's are doing a roaring trade in sacrificial cocks.
Sounds madly depraved.
Yeah, terribly us, isn't it?
In the country at the time, even geographically, we split up in a way that's almost inconceivable now. The motorways hadn't started to be built, and television really wasn't existing at that time. You know, the country was almost like Germany in the 19th century, a series of nation states. So when, say, films, as they said, from the north came, it was like investigating a different world. There were still whole strange areas that knew nothing about the way the other lived.
Flat brown, they must coin it, you know. All those chimneys, that's money. Beautiful, beautiful brass, belching out every minute of the day and night.
Come on.
You know, Charles, I've been thinking about that dramatic club.
Well?
You remember you said you needed men, fresh blood and all that? Did you mean it?
I certainly did.
Lawrence Harvey was under contract to producer James Wolfe, who, with his brother John, had dreams of a British cinema which could be exported successfully to other countries. The two were well-established industry figures who had no particular inclination to northern subjects, but had simply responded to the energy of Room at the Top's leading character.
It was ambition. He had this enormous ambition in life. Came from this run-down Yorkshire family. The difficulty we had over that, one of the difficulties was the accent. We didn't quite know what accent to have because we didn't want to be we wanted it to be understandable throughout the world, particularly in America. We had a dialogue coach who gave us a choice of a number of Yorkshire accents, and we took the middle one.
The British films that had filtered through to America when I was growing up there gave an impression of cheery bobbies, impenetrable London fogs, and plenty of stiff upper lips. And things hadn't changed all that much when I arrived here in the 50s. British cinema was in a bad state. Sound familiar? In a period of increasing affluence, people were choosing to spend their money elsewhere. Movies had fallen behind the times. But the thrusting northern hero of Room at the Top provided a welcome challenge to the public school types who still seemed to dominate the screen.
Now, what's all this about?
Please go away. You've no right to come in here.
I've every right to know why you're out every time I telephone. Why you lock yourself up in this dismal house if you were terrified at the sight of me?
I just don't want to see you anymore, that's all.
Liar.
Roger, please go.
Oh, we're very nice, you know.
I'm sure you
The are. Doctor films, made by the Rank Organization, were a hugely successful series at the time, although the humor always seemed a bit on the genteel side. They belonged to the safe and cozy world of the pre-permissive society, in which the overtly sexy roles were usually given to continentals. In this case, an unknown French actress, Brigitte Bardot.
What did the other have?
A doctor.
Are those two your patients?
Sort of.
Well, keep an eye on them. Their temperatures are rising.
Mine's not very steady.
For the predatory temptress of Room at the Top, the Wolfe brothers selected French actress Simone Signoret, despite the book clearly making her a local girl.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
Well, I remember my brother and I, we were discussing a really good line for it, and we came eventually together. We got this idea, a savage story, a blessed ambition. It sounds rather old-fashioned now, but it wasn't so old-fashioned then.
But lust and ambition attracted an ex-certificate from the censor, at that time commercial disaster for any film hoping for widespread distribution.
I care very much about the kind of film that the artist makes. Now, the artist may well be in advance of public attitudes. And he may shock, but shock deliberately. I think this is fair enough. I'm not greatly concerned about the artist in these terms, but I'm much more concerned about the commercial element which tries to cash in on a situation.
course, all trailers must carry a U certificate. We are unable to show you scenes which the censor has passed for adult audiences only.
There was a full gathering of the British Film Academy to learn which stars and what films were to receive the...
Although not immediately well received by British critics, Room at the Top went on to become the fourth most successful film of the year, behind Carry On Nurse, I'm All Right Jack, and The Inn of the Sixth Happiness.
Room at the Top.
John and James Wolfe, producers of the film, went up to receive the honor, and altogether it was a most pleasant evening for them.
Oscar night!
But in America, where they had fewer problems with working class heroes, the film went straight to the top and was acclaimed as the harbinger of a new British cinema.
Jimmy Wolfe and Jack Clayton and Lawrence Harvey, because it looks a little corny to say that, but you know that without them I wouldn't have never been here tonight. Thank you so much.
The new British hero had actually been born in the theatre in John Osborne's Look Back in Anger. Tony Richardson, who had directed the play at the Royal Court Theatre and was one of the original Angry Young Men, used the profits of the production to set up Woodfall Films with John Osborne. Look Back in Anger was their first film. It opened in the same year as Room at the Top, but didn't quite enjoy the same success. Richardson, however, was determined to press home the new freedoms on the screen.
I think that there are certain things that people, certain films people might want to make, which might require scenes in them which couldn't possibly be shot under the present circumstances. And I think that's a bad thing, because I think you should be able to say or do anything on the screen. I don't believe in any form of censorship whatsoever. I mean, with all the dangers that it might expose people too, I still think that films should be made so that people can see anything that they want to see.
Tony was the Diaghilev of the organizer. He was the impresario. He's the one that got the money. He was the one that said, well, okay, we want to make these films. Well, let's make them, and I'll get you the money. I mean, my first feature film, Tony by that time had Woodfall, and he said to me, is there anything you'd like to make a film of? And 3 or 4 weeks later, I went back to him with a novel, and he said, well, all right. And it all seemed quite simple.
Space, and in it there were about five streets and terraces all running parallel to each other, and they ended at a wall, and beyond the wall was the whole extent of the Raleigh factory. I'd get up at 6 in the morning, and by just after 7 I'd be walking down this street, and I'd turn left at the bottom. And within 2 or 3 minutes, I was clocking in at the Raleigh factory, which I did from the age of 14. What impressed me most was the phenomenal noise. I suppose, in a way, it was like going into a sort of front line. The filming in the factory, where it begins, Albert Finney standing on the exact place I stood on when I went into work at 14. So everything is so authentic that the film is like a kind of social document apart from the story.
The reality of working the lathe, I found that very exciting. Of just when I was being photographed working at that lathe, that I could absolutely concentrate on what the character was supposed to do. There was no cheating involved.
954. Nine
950 bloody five. Another few more and that's a lot for a Friday.
But I felt very strongly about the reality of it. I sympathised with Arthur's situation. I did sympathise with his feeling of being trapped in there or seeing himself at that machine for the next 40 years of his life.
I'd love to see anybody try to grind me down. That'd be the day. What I'm out for is a good time. All the rest is propaganda.
Saturday night and Sunday morning made Albert Finney a star. He'd already set the stage alight when he'd taken over from Laurence Olivier in Coriolanus. Now, on screen, he embodied a new kind of sexy working-class hero. And Woodfall, as well as trumpeting their new star, were also keen to suggest that the film was crossing new frontiers of frankness.
It makes Room at the Top look like a vicarage tea party.
Don't let you stay down here too long. The time we had last night.
Commercially, it is just miraculous. After the first week and a half of its London release, it had its money back and made an enormous amount of money for everybody all over the world. Yes, it really touched a nerve, as Room at the Top had done, as Taste of Honey was to do, as Tom Jones did. Yes, there was a real, what the audience was saying, yes, it's time to make pictures about what's outside the drawing room.
In 1959, a group of French film critics directed their first feature films. They acquired the rather fanciful Gallic tag La Nouvelle Vague, or New Wave, and it stuck. François Truffaut's debut, The 400 Blows, with its informal, tender style of filmmaking, appealed to audiences and critics alike. Truffaut and his star, the unknown non-actor Jean-Pierre Léo, were the sensation of the 1959 Cannes Film Festival. And when The 400 Blows came to London the following year, it made a huge impression on young British filmmakers, particularly on Tony Richardson.
Look Back and Anger and The Entertainer were made as studio films, and Tony was really sort of finding his feet, I think. But with Taste of Honey, he got into his own, and he was working with very untried actors, which, of course, he liked because he could control them.
I was working backstage at Liverpool West at the time, and I read in the newspaper they were looking for an unknown actress to play the role of Jo in A Taste of Honey. And I didn't even know the play, but I thought, oh, well, maybe that'll be for me. But you do things when you're young you probably wouldn't do when you're older. And I did an audition. And they called one day and said, Tony called and said, you've got the part on. And I got the role, but it was a year before we actually started shooting the film. A lot of things were said about my look when I first started in the business. And I was lucky it didn't affect me. I mean, it could have really given me such an inferiority complex. I might never have sort of worked again or gone out. It didn't sort of worry me, which was lucky, because I suppose, yeah, I did look very different. It's very different for someone that looked like me to be playing the lead role in a film.
Bill, let me give you a hand.
Thanks very much. Look here.
My first appearance, I leap onto the bus and flirt with her. Now, I was very self-confident. I thought I was good-looking and, you know, Shakespeare and all that, and I relied more on that in my acting. And I sort of, I was very at ease doing this, you know. Young black man, good looking, meets a nice girl and so on. And our thing together was immediate.
There was a happy young man without a care in the world.
The nice girl in A Taste of Honey was a moony schoolgirl warring with her mother in a succession of seedy bed sits near the Manchester docks.
Did your ancestors come from Africa?
No, Liverpool. Were you expecting to marry a man whose father beat the tom-tom?
There's still a bit of jungle in you somewhere.
Tony Richardson's artless, unhysterical portrait of an interracial love affair was new in British cinema, as was his handling of the other key relationship in the film, between the Rita Tushingham character and a young man she eventually sets up house with, Geoffrey.
I've been looking for you. I've
poisoned you up till now.
I'm going to have a baby.
Yes, I thought so. You're in a bit of a mess, aren't you?
Geoffrey has a worldly wiseness about him that can cope. He's a coper. But then that very often happens in a relationship, doesn't it? That one person is a coper. He met a young girl who was also, in her way, having a struggle against her background and what was called a normal life for that sort of society. So there were two people breaking through into a new world.
Oh, I don't care.
You can get rid of babies before they're born, you know.
Yes, I know. They think that's terrible.
When's it due?
About November.
Suddenly, they were demanding a right to be there, to be single parents, or to be homosexual, or to be black, as individual people.
You're just feeling a bit depressed, that's all. You'll be your usual self once you get used to the idea.
And what is my usual self? My usual self is a very unusual self. And don't you forget that, Geoffrey Ingham. I'm an extraordinary person. There's only one of me, like there's only one of you.
We're unique.
Young.
Unrivaled.
Flashy.
We're bloody marvellous.
We're bloody marvellous. And that period was for young artists. Filmmakers, actors, writers. It was a great renaissance, wasn't it? Of that breakthrough from the strictures of that society.
How would you like to go to the country?
Wonderful. Hey, come on.
But with the success of Room at the Top, and particularly Saturday Night and Sunday Morning, some mainstream filmmakers were beginning to think that the North of England had commercial and aesthetic possibilities. Beaver Films, founded by former actors Richard Attenborough and Brian Forbes, had bought the rights to a novel by Mary Haley Bell and were in search of a suitable location.
Directors certainly were enchanted with the North at that time. I mean, at one time you couldn't walk around the slag heaps without tripping over a light cable. I mean, they were roaming all over the place at one time. I mean, they made a discovery of the North. It's a great place to film.
The production's other blue chip asset was Hayley Mills.
Well, at that time, she was the number one box office star in the world. She'd made Pollyanna for Disney and was the sort of natural successor to Shirley Temple. And she was very, very big. And she was very much in demand, and they were looking for a suitable vehicle for her. And this proved to be it.
I don't care who's coming. Go back and shut it.
We just got a phone call, I think, from Dickie Attenborough.
Yes, from Dickie Attenborough. It was a book, it was set in the home counties, actually, and it was very much sort of pony clubs and all that, and Dickie wanted it set in the North, and so he sort of threw the book at us and said, Northernize it, which we did. I think it works better as a film set in the North because it has a nice abrasive kind of quality which goes against what could have been a rather airy-fairy kind of story.
You don't go far, I'll your tea ready.
Yes, Auntie. Did he ask you? What did you tell him?
Nothing.
Did he tell me a lie?
I told him nothing.
Come on, mate, quick.
It just had everything I wanted. I mean, it had the landscape behind it, it had the stream, it had the old barn, and nothing was very sort of smart. It just had an air of isolation which worked perfectly for the film, I thought. I mean, this wonderful light that you get up north.
The rather precarious premise of Whistle Down the Wind was that a murderer on the run and hiding out in the barn is taken by the children to be Jesus Christ.
Is he dead?
Of course not.
That isn't Jesus.
Well, it is then, Mr. Clever Dick.
Jesus wore a long dress.
Well, that was in them days.
I think it was memory and our own memories of being kids in Leeds, and although we were urban kids, there was a lot of rural life around us. You know, there were fields and farms. Although we'd never personally met Jesus in a barn, we had the kind of life that those kids had.
This is the famous barn. Behind me, we put bales of straw up to a level, and that's where they hid him after a certain length of time that had elapsed. Alan Bates used to lie there in the early sequence, and then Ray Sim, my art director, of course, tricked it up. We put stalls in there, as I remember.
Whistle Down the Wind was Pinewood on an expedition to the north of England. Although the crew did return to the studios to film the interior of the farmhouse kitchen. Pinewood at that time still thought itself the headquarters of the British film industry. The Italian producer, Joseph Yanni, another important contributor to the British New Wave, was working there in 1958 when he spotted a promising film on the BBC's innovative Monitor program.
I made, with some difficulty, a film about a scratch Italian opera company coming to Theatre Royal Drury Lane. The film was quite successful, and it came, obviously drew the attention of Joe Yanni, who was a well-known independent producer at Rank. I went to see him. He's from Milan and wonderfully Italian. And he said, when I went to see him, I would like to discover you.
So when I left Pinewood, I was determined to make a film of the provinces. And I read Child of Navi. And I said, I'd love to make this film.
A Kind of Loving was another successful northern novel, this time by the Burnley writer Stan Barstow. Keith Waterhouse and Willis Hall were again engaged as adapters, and Yanni and his team went off in search of quintessential northern locations.
We'd take him into a backstreet fish and chip shop, and he'd treat every place as if it were the Ritz, and everybody as if they were, wonderful people and so on. He asked for and got in this fish and chip oil a green salad. He asked, could I have a glass of water, do you think? And the lady behind the counter hissed at me, what's up, has he got to take some tablets?
It's funny, isn't it?
Hmm? What?
Well, I was just thinking. You know, we've worked together for the same firm for 3 years, and we've never talked to each other before.
Mm. Yes, it is funny, isn't it?
Yes.
You were at the wedding the other day, weren't you?
Yes, we're sisters.
So are you standing there? I love weddings.
Well, I've got some photos of it. If you'd like to see them.
Yes, I'd like to.
This is the first location up here of my first film. And I cannot tell you, rounding this corner, the first day of shooting of my first major film, how nervous I was. And I was with Alan Bates in the car, and I don't know why I'd like to turn back, not have to face this. And watching all the crew and the trucks lined up here. Very nerve-wracking.
The film was also the first leading role for Alan Bates. His character's dreams of travel and adventure are destined to be forfeited after his cinema date leads to a shotgun wedding and he finds himself living here with his nagging mother-in-law. Audiences flocked to A Kind of Loving. They identified with Alan Bates' longing to change his circumstances and his frustrated resignation at being unable to do so.
Morality has changed since then. People would now say, oh, leave her for God's sake. Give yourself a chance. You know. I think that environment and was kind of, one felt more isolated perhaps. I could believe that one could feel more isolated then.
A northerner who did manage to make an early escape was David Story, who had dreams of life in the South as an artist and writer, but also had to hold down a career as a professional rugby league player.
Why were you so determined to leave it behind?
It's so awful. I was playing professional football at the time, but I'd only done that in order to pay to enable me to paint pictures and write, because it only required 2 evenings training and 1 match a week, and the rest of the time I could devote, I thought, to writing and painting. But it quickly became apparent that it wasn't very easy to do it. The book actually really began in the middle of a football match at Leeds, when in the middle of the game, I suddenly realised if I picked up the ball, which had just come loose at my feet, I'd get my teeth knocked in. And it was just happened in a fraction of a second, and I hesitated. And an old pro who was playing with me in the forwards just instinctively picked it up and lost his teeth. And he looked up at me, and I won't say what he said, but the force with which he said it suddenly gave me a vision of a man.
Oh, get some weight into it! Come on, get some
weight! He was very strange. He's non-communicative at all, I think, which was wonderful for me because I styled the character basically on him and his brother. I'd met the brother a couple of times, and that dark, brooding look the brother had, I watched him quite a bit, took it from him, and David as well. I'd watched David a lot. I thought it was so sort of raw, and the emotions were so real. And sort of in a strange way, sort of so unpretentious, I mean, so simple in a strange way.
This sporting life depicted Northern passion and repression with a candor that was often painful to watch. The paralleling of the raw world of rugby league with the domestic drama between the Richard Harris character and his emotionally walled-up landlady amounted to a real pathology of the North.
Making this sporting life was a very tough and emotional experience. And Richard was not the easiest of actors, but his difficulty, if you like, concealed or was present with a very strongly emotional and willful attitude. This could be hard work to control. And I often say, I mean, if people feel any exhaustion of emotion after watching that film, which I think they do, it was all there in the shooting.
You make me feel I'm nothing.
I want you.
No, you want to crush me, but I won't let you, because I'm the one thing you can't have like everything else.
I want you.
I want you to go.
I need you.
I want you to go. I want you to go. I want you to go.
I remember that after I just had a huge row with Richard about some scene, I remember someone on the floor coming up to me and saying, well, say, never mind, Doug, you know, on your next picture you may get Margaret Lockwood. He wasn't saying this ironically. He said she always hits her marks. Well, I always felt that it was worth going through it all if the result was good.
While Lindsay Anderson was wrestling with his wayward cast in Wakefield, a pop group in Liverpool was bringing out its first record. And the BBC were trying out a new satirical comedy show.
That was the week that was.
There was a spirit of irreverence which began to reach even the slag heaps of the North. Simultaneously with the filming of This Sporting Life, John Schlesinger and Joseph Yanni were shooting the follow-up to A Kind of Loving, Keith Waterhouse and Willis Hall's escapist fantasy, Billy Liar.
That's Billy's house, Hillcrest, and we're in the Billy Liar suburbs, the place that he wants to get away from. What it tells Billy is, to him, it's accepts everything that's dreary about life.
Every morning. Hey, you up there? Come on, get out of it.
The hopeless dreamer, Billy, was played by Tom Courtney.
It was a big day for us. We had won the war in Ambrosia. Democracy was back once more in our beloved country.
Billy himself is really based on a whole gang of us who used to hang around in the milk bars and make plans and dreams of coming to London.
I've been offered a job in London.
Eh, there's been a lot of twins born lately.
I said I have been offered a job in London.
What bloody job?
How do you mean you've been offered a job?
A job script writing.
Script writing? He can't write his own bloody names, but anybody can read it.
I'm going up to London to see script writing. Bloody script writing. That was the father, and I knew so well, you know, from my own father. You. I used to get a lot. You. Act the bloody go. That's all acting you do. And it just was, gosh. I mean, I just knew what it was about.
Good morning, Billy. Good morning.
If I can get to the end of the street without opening my eyes, everything will be all right.
We're in Bradford. This is where the undertaker's shop was located, where Billy worked.
Broaden the time to come to work, Fisher. I'm sorry, Mr. Shadrack. Only I spilled all that water down my arm. I've been to the doctor's.
Must be going home time. Fisher's here.
I worked for an undertaker. I selected the job because I found that I had the use of a typewriter where I used to write short stories at lunchtime.
You still are an undertaker during the day, aren't you?
Oh, yes.
That's the day job.
Still the day job, yeah.
Well, I tell you what, I mean, the workers nowadays, you see, you give them chocolate safety a week, they're not content.
They don't know the ball.
They don't know when they're well off.
They couldn't come it with me.
No.
There's always been an all right, it's all right, you know.
The film represents a tussle between what is traditional in his life, and into his life comes the character played by Julie Christie.
Christie was spotted at the Central School of Speech and Drama by Joseph Yanni in a production of The Diary of Anne Frank. He immediately wanted to put her under contract.
So I went to, I said, look, Julie, this is my address. Come tomorrow to my office and I will give you a contract. And for a kick, she said to say, shit, everybody said that.
That's the way a lot of young women were, certainly the way that myself and my friends were. And it was just a question that we were allowed to be as we were, as on film. I mean, a lot of people would walk along swinging a handbag and running their hands along the rails. That's not such an unusual thing to do. But previous to that, perhaps you would be introduced. And you think what I was wearing, I mean, it was just a real tacky old coat. And I think it was a fake suede coat. And there wasn't anything remotely smart about anything that I had on or how I was made up or anything. And that was the change, that how we were was how we were allowed to be presented, because previously you wouldn't have been allowed to be presented like that. You think of the you know, the joke that in the 50s or the previous to that, women could go through hell and high water and they'd still have their hair absolutely immaculate, and that was what was presented, how women were presented beforehand. So I think it was I didn't feel, oh, look, I'm being a new girl or a new woman or anything like that. I just was grateful that I didn't have to go through this ridiculous charade.
Well, she brought sex to the character.
Well, indeed, yes. I mean, it was very unusual for any girl to admit that she was a sort of sexy person. I mean, they pretended otherwise. They pretended that they weren't, and that they were all doing it for you, you know. I mean, any girl who admitted that she was also doing it for herself was a very unusual, forward-looking sort of Ibsen character.
And a good one's fine.
Oh, Billy, look!
But Billy's current fiancé is a girl in a far more conventional northern mold.
Isn't it sweet?
And,
true to his calling as an undertaker, Billy does his courting in a cemetery, where his overtures have to observe the niceties of romantic etiquette.
Do you think it's wrong for people to have, feelings?
Not if they genuinely love each other.
Like we do.
Yes.
What do you think it's wrong of me to have feelings?
People knew what they were doing, even if they weren't allowed to do it. Young men always went around with a packet of three in their top pocket. I mean, they remained in their pocket until they perished.
Packet of three forever. Yes. Well, there was probably more chasing, but less catching, I should think, in those.
Yes.
The disconcerting Julie Christie character wants to cut through all the preliminaries.
You know what you wanted me to do that night when we were walking through the park. And I said another night.
Yes.
Well, it's another night tonight, isn't it?
Are you sure?
Yes.
What?
Now, she could be quite loose. I mean, she did what she wanted to do. But she was still present. It was a strength, actually. It was presented as a strength. So I suppose that was a wonderful part, actually. That's one of the best parts I've ever had. Because on the whole, women did get quite a raw deal in the 60s. Liz was quite unique.
But, Billy, why don't you go to London? I'll come with you.
Oh, it'd be marvellous if we could.
But there was no prospect of escape for this sporting life's Frank Machen.
How are you, lad? Knock now, Johnson, in a hurry.
After the blow which knocks his teeth out, Frank Machen emerges onto the terraces here at Halifax, unaware that his love affair is doomed and the decline in his fortunes as a player has already started. Like its hero, the film didn't draw the crowds. In retrospect, This Sporting Life is possibly the finest of the British New Wave films, but it came too late. It was seen as another depressing northern tale, and the audience had had enough.
Probably This Sporting Life did not correspond to what its audiences expected from a night out at the cinema, or an entertainment. And particularly, it wasn't received happily by the head of the Rank organization, who disliked it very much.
I think the film is a little bit bitter for the big audience. It was also, by now, the fifth or sixth film in this cycle, and charm was going off the new cinema. It was a real succès d'estime without being a hugely popular film.
And I think at the end of that, would it be 63, would it? Was a very significant article, I think, in the Evening Standard, which quoted John Davies saying, from now on, the Rank organization were going to make purely entertainment pictures. And it was headed, "The Year the Kitchen Sink Went Down the Drain." Now, even to talk about those writers, those subjects, those films, in terms of kitchen sink, was an extremely middle-class thing to do. But I think that feeling, that tradition, is extremely strong in this country, and has remained so.
But in 1963, cinema audiences were clearly beginning to lose interest in working-class realism. Billy Lyre came out in the same year as This Sporting Life, and it took care to market itself very differently, with the emphasis on fantasy and the zany optimism which signaled the arrival of the swinging 60s.
But Billy, why don't you go to London? I'll come with you.
At the end of the film, Billy's dreams of escape seem about to become reality when he meets up with his girlfriend on this station. It was supposed to be Bradford, but they shot it here in Marylebone in London. Anyway, it seemed at last that a northern lad might actually make it to the big city. But Billy loses his nerve. And in the end, it's Julie Christie who makes the break and sets off for a new life in London.
Hollywood UK continues next Thursday at 9:40. Tonight, high and low lights of a week of British telly. Brand new Charlie Brooker's Screen Wipes next.
This isn't about one person. This isn't ego music. This isn't me music. Because traditional music is about thousands of minds.
The Crossfire range from 24,995 now with free smart.
Now I've got so many.
On my tombstone, it would say he added to the spirit of the production.